Yadana! Welcome, everybody. Welcome to another Tahitian Moment Live. It's Thursday, 5 p.m. Eastern Time, and I do this every Thursday. And I always look forward to it. I see comments coming in already, an active group. Thank you, Wen. This says she always looks forward to Thursdays as well. Thank you. I'm really, I really love that so many people do tune in each week, and Some of you I know really well, and some of you I only know by your picture and your name, but you're here every week, and it's a great turnout showing up here this week already. So as always, please feel free to drop a comment, say hello so I know who's watching. Shoot a like if you enjoy the video, you enjoy the presentation, please give me a like, drop your comments. I just go through a few here that are online already. Maddie Gray, hello Maddie, welcome from New Jersey, thank you for joining. Brad, welcome back once again, South Carolina. Who else do we have? Bob, welcome back, Bob. Thanks for joining once again. And Hillary and Larry, thank you. We have your final confirmations just in that home stretch now. And before you know it, your trip will be up. And Liz, thank you again, Liz, for joining all the time, and happy, happy Thursday to you as well. So yes, thank you everybody for joining. For those of you that don't know me, my name's Carl. I own and operate Tahiti by Carl. And what I do is I help take the complexity out of planning and booking customized, memorable Tahitian vacations. So many of you that are watching here today are either booked for a trip coming up or you've just gotten back. So it's great to see you. And I keep on saying I need to do this is to have some of my past clients join me and just do a show with past clients, because I think that would be a lot of fun. So if you're interested in that, drop me a line. Who else do we have? Michael, thank you for joining, Michael. Michael just got back last week, followed along on his great trip with on Facebook there. It was so nice to follow along and see it all. It was amazing. Who else we have? Brennan Ann. Oh, Brennan Ann, thank you for joining. So Brennan Ann are all booked for a great trip. And no sooner do we have Ann booked than she's starting to talk about trip number two. I don't know if Brennan knows that, Ann. Maybe I shouldn't say that, but Fred, thanks again for joining, Fred. Fred is off at the end of this year as well. So many clients, past and present. I love it. Love it, love it, love it. So today, what are we going to talk about today? So today you've just got me, so please feel free to interact as much as you like. that's got to be Ann typing these comments, not Bren. please feel free to comment, ask any questions as we go along. I am doing a solo show for you here today. Last week we had John Kincaid join me from Kincaid Galleries. If you haven't seen his pictures or didn't catch it last week, you can go back on the YouTube and catch an episode of that. John is such an amazing photographer. I absolutely love his pictures and his work. You can buy his pictures online, but he also has a gallery right there at the St. Regis Bora Bora as well. So it's really, some real amazing stuff. But one of the things that I said that we would do last week that I thought would be a neat addition to the show would be every week to feature some photos of past clients of mine that have traveled, just to have a couple pictures, just to share, you know, some of their favorites and what, you know, things that they may have enjoyed when they were down there. So I have my clients, Harold and Olga, which I don't know if they're watching today or they're busy working, but Harold was nice enough to volunteer first for this new little project I hope to do every single week. And he has sent me in a couple pictures from their trip. They did an amazing trip where they were in Moorea, and they were from Moorea. They went over to Bora Bora, and they did Little Bora Bora, and they did the Intercontinental Thalasso. So three different properties. And he sent me two different pictures here from Bora Bora that I'll just share with you. And they are beautiful. Harold is an amazing photographer. And as you can see from his first picture, this is taken at the Intercontinental Thalasso at sunset. Beautiful reflection, beautiful, beautiful sunset there. Oh, Harold is here. Harold, thank you for joining and thank you for sharing the pictures. I'm bragging about your photography skills here. I know Harold's passionate about his photography. It's always been a hobby of mine too, and I've lost it a little bit as I've gotten older and cell phones have kind of taken over, and I just do most of my stuff on my cell phone, but you can still get some great shots on this cell phone. But if you were ever to come to my house, my whole house is filled with pictures of all my own travels from all over the world, which I love, because everywhere I go, I see, you know, memories, and it brings back those good times. So this was one of Harold's pictures that he took here at sunset at the Intercontinental Thalasso, which I think is absolutely stunning. It's gallery quality. It's amazing. Next one that he has sent me as well is another one there in Bora Bora. So just some beautiful shots that you can see. If you're not a big photographer, I really encourage you to go back and watch the episode that we did last week with John Kincaid. As a professional photographer, he talked about things that you can do when you're lining up your photos and settings that you can change on your phones to help you get better pictures. So I thought that was a neat topic, and I had a lot of clients, you know, comment back on that topic and how much they enjoyed it. So Harold, thank you so much for sharing these gorgeous, gorgeous photos. If you want to see more of Harold's pictures, because he has a ton, he was nice enough to say I could share his Instagram account here. And you can find him on Instagram at Waddington World. So if you look up at Waddington World, and he has a ton of pictures from his trip posted on there. So you'll see pictures from Bora Bora and from Bora Bora and Moorea on his Instagram channel. So feel free to follow him on there and enjoy his gorgeous, gorgeous photos. And we're talking about his third trip back too, so there hopefully will be more to come. Thanks again, Harold. And for anybody that's watching me right now, and if you've been down there with me, please speak up if you would like to send a couple of your favorite pictures in, and even a little story about why they're your favorites. They don't have to be scenery pictures. It could be your favorite dinner, it could be your favorite tour, it could be your favorite Polynesian that you met, you know, whatever it is. It would be nice just to have a little touch of people's experiences and their own personal images from their trip. And they don't have to be gallery quality like Harold are here. I'm not looking for that, but don't ask me to pick. I don't want to pick. So just send me your two pictures and what it is that you'd like, you know, anything that goes along with them. And I'll be happy to feature them next week or the week after, whatever the case is. But I have nobody lined up yet for next week. So please send away if you've got some. So yes, and Harold can't wait to go back. Harold goes down with the family too, so he takes the kids. So it's not just a place for couples. You know, they had a great time this time with the first time taking their two kids down. So Tony and Eva, those are amazing. I want to be that talented when I grow up. you can message Harold on Waddington World for any tips. And I know he's got a great lineup of photography equipment that he uses as well. So if you need to pick up anything before you go down, you know, he can always maybe give you a tip or two there as well. And comment from when you turn the grid lines on your iPhone. Excellent. I've had a few people when tell me that they've turned their grid lines on, and I have always kept my grid lines on for years on my phone, and I really like it, because it just, for me, it just reminds me of the rule of thirds and you know, lining up the pictures. So yeah, I think the grid lines are great. Okay, so today sorry, one second here. Whoops. Shoot. I do apologize. Every time I click on that, I end up going the wrong direction. So what we're going to talk about today, sorry, and do excuse me. For those of you that follow me, you know, I had COVID like about 2-3 weeks ago. I still have this annoying cough that has not gone away, and that's absolutely driving me crazy. It's not bad, but it's just that annoyance. So today we're going to talk about 10 things to know before your first trip to Tahiti. You know, it's always one of those things, you get down to a destination, anywhere you're traveling, like, oh, I wish I knew that before I left, right? So I try to work with all my clients to make sure that all of this is done in advance. I notify you in advance, you know, of anything that, to help you plan. I know everybody watching this video is not booking with me. I strongly feel that you should be booking with me or a Tahiti expert to get the best Tahitian vacation. There's no point in doing it on your own. I know people like that challenge, but man, when things go wrong, and I know there's people on this webinar right now that have had that happen, when flights have been canceled, you arrive a day late, when tours get canceled, you know, Tahiti just had this huge, crazy swell come into the lagoons and all water activities were shut down. You know, I was able to get my clients canceled and rebooked for different days. And, you know, there's lots unexpected that can happen. We always hope that it doesn't happen, but having an expert on your side is so, so worth it. But today we're going to talk about 10 things to know before you go for your first trip to Tahiti. And the number one thing I want to talk about is the entry requirements. We've had some crazy times in the last 2 years, and we still have some crazy times right now where very close detail must be paid attention when you travel anywhere, because the travel entry requirements, not like grab your passport and let's hit the plane. I mean, it might be, but it may not be. And what it is today can be different than 5 days from now, 30 days from now, 6 months from now. So you have to continuously watch. Thankfully, it's getting easier everywhere we go as time goes on. But nonetheless, you still have to be careful. So case in point, number one, passports. A lot of people have not traveled for a long time. Pull your passport out right away. Take a look at it. When does it expire? Mark it on your calendar. Get that baby renewed at least 6 months before your expiry date. It's super important. Some countries, French Polynesia, your passport has to be valid for at least 3 months after your return date back. So you need to have some buffer on there. Some countries are 6 months, depending on where in the world you might be traveling. Some countries are 6 months. So it's really important that not only is your passport valid, but it's also, you've got that extra buffer time at the end, depending on where it is you're traveling and what the rules and regulations are. But the other thing that's so important right now is I think every passport office around the world is completely backlogged. It's taking much longer to get your passports renewed than it has in the past. I know they're working hard and things are slowly getting better, both in Canada and the US than what it was. But nonetheless, it does take extra time. So please have a look at your passports well in advance and make sure that they're up to date. COVID, as much as we like to say it's gone away, we want it to be gone away, it's not gone away. Rules and regulations are continually changing all the time for destinations. It's held steady for quite some time now for French Polynesia, and I'm very happy about that. If you're fully vaccinated, all you have to do is bring your proof of vaccination and your passport, and you don't have to do any extra paperwork. You don't have to do any tests coming back into the US. You don't have to test coming back into Canada. You don't have to test. So it's getting great if you're fully vaccinated. But you have to look, what are the rules? What classifies as fully vaccinated? So fully vaccinated for French Polynesia is 2 shots, but then you have to have a booster within 9 months of your second shot. But for a lot of people now, we've had that booster, but now we're up to at least 9 months since we've had that booster. So you need to get another booster. And people are getting caught. They go to fly down to Tahiti and they haven't had their boosters. And therefore, they don't qualify to travel as a fully vaccinated traveler. And in that case, you can still go to Tahiti if you're not vaccinated, but you have to get a COVID test done 48 hours prior with an antigen test or 72 hours prior to an RT-PCR test. So it's super, super important to know and understand the regulations and know where you stand and to double check what your status is, okay? Because like I said, you can travel if you're unvaccinated, it's not a problem, but you have to do the test if that's the case. Mask and no mask, once again, everybody's got their own stance on this. I'm not here to debate all of that. But the depending on where you're traveling, and these rules could change again, because I just heard California is talking about reinstating masking in the airports. Canada is still law that you wear a mask on a plane. So for any of my Canadian clients traveling from Canada to the US, it is mandatory that you wear a mask in the airports and on the planes. That is the law. So just because in your day-to-day lives, we may not be wearing masks. Remember, when you travel, it could be different. So stay up to date on that. Any entry paperwork, right now it's very minimal. Us Canadians coming back to Canada, though, even though if you're fully vaccinated, you don't have to test, you don't have to quarantine or anything like that, we still must do the ArriveCan app. For the US, they've pretty much gotten rid of all the paperwork, which is really nice. And then travel visas, for anybody watching this, for all my Canadians and my American clients, we don't have to worry about travel visas going down to French Polynesia. But depending if you're coming from a different country around the world, you always have to watch and see if you need a travel visa and apply for those well in advance. Logistics. So getting around, little things that you need to think about. It might be going by a beautiful helicopter like this. It might be going by a ferry. But regardless of what it is, people book. I mean, true story. I had somebody call me. He watched one of my videos on, I think it was one of my videos on all the excursions to do in Bora Bora. And he's got a trip booked to Bora Bora. And he wanted to use me to book some excursions. And I don't book only excursions. I only book full packages. I've tried to do just excursions. It's way too time consuming. And then I don't have time to service my other clients. So I've had to say, no, I only do full packages. And he's like, well, let me cancel what I booked and you rebook it. He goes, I can cancel it. I'm like, sure, no problem. This is the price for the hotels and flights. And I'm like, so what are your flights? And he gives me his flight details into Papiette. And then he goes, and then I said, so what flight do you have booked over to Bora Bora? He goes, oh no, I'm taking the boat. And I'm like, the boat? You know, there is no boat over to Bora Bora. Well, I mean, now there technically is a ferry, but it's like a milk run and it's horrible. But that didn't exist back then. He goes, no, I thought everything I read, it says you land at the airport and the resort picks you up at the airport and takes you by boat. And he didn't realize that he's landing in Papiette and he still has to do a 50-minute flight over to Bora Bora. So little things like this, he said to me afterwards, he said, thank goodness. He goes, I would have showed up at the airport and been totally lost. And I know from resort managers, this has happened to other people as well. You know, they phone the resort and they're at the airport and they're looking for their transfer and they're at the Papiette airport instead of the Bora Bora airport, right? So getting around, planning your transfers is super important. With the exception of the main island of Tahiti, you can't necessarily just flag down a taxi. Most of them don't have them. You have to pre-book them. You have to have the resorts call them for you. You know, if you're somewhere like Bora Bora, it's mostly water transfers. Water taxis can be available, but they are very expensive. So it's really important that everything is pre-planned and pre-booked so you're taken care of. You want this to be a seamless trip. And this is what I will do for all of my clients. Everything will be, you know, planned and booked for you for getting around transfers. Some other little tips to think about is checking in and check out times, because people don't realize sometimes when you fly down, you might land at 5 a.m. and the resort check-in time isn't until 3 p.m. And after you've been doing long international flights, that's a long wait to get a room, right? You're tired, you're exhausted, you want a shower, you want a nap, whatever the case. So really look at those check-in, check-out times. Again, another time I had a client come to me looking for some help, and they booked a flight that left Bora Bora at 11 a.m. back to Papiette at 12 noon, and they were flying out at midnight. I'm like, well, what are you doing for 12 hours? And they're like, oh, we don't know. We'll just store our luggage somewhere and go do something. We can't do that. Papiette doesn't have a luggage storage. They used to. They don't anymore, right? So if you don't have a day room booked with transfers, or, you know, you're going to end up carrying your luggage around for 12 hours while you try to explore the city. So there's little things like that need to pay attention to, your check-in, check-out times. Pickup locations, super important. Your pickup locations if you're booking tours. You know, a lot of people are booking tours online with some online booking engine. They don't really know who's behind it. Most of these online booking engines are not located in French Polynesia, and they just pick up into a feed. Technology now is crazy. You know, it's picked into a feed and away we go. But some of them don't realize that they're not picked up at the resort. They have to go meet the tour somewhere. So if that's the case, you have to be really careful to make sure you know where it is that you're getting picked up and dropped off. And then one final thing here on logistics, I just want to mention is your international flights. It is so important when you are planning your trip to Tahiti to pay careful attention to your international flights. We all know if you watch any bit of news these days, the airports and the airlines are having a very challenging time. There are staffing shortages from pilots to flight attendants to people loading the bags to people working at the airports to the security screening to the customs, like you name it. Sadly, where I live here in Toronto took the not so proud award of being the worst airport in the world last month for delays, which is horrible. But this is really tough when you've got connecting flights. A lot of people are booking two separate flights. They book one flight into Los Angeles for San Francisco, and they book a second flight down to Tahiti. You might save some money there, but it's really important for you to know that if you book your flight separately like that, if this flight is delayed or canceled or has a schedule change, which happens a lot these days, and you misconnect on your other flight, the airlines aren't responsible for you protecting you. So if you have to pay to change one of your two flights, that's your dime, or you have to try to make an insurance claim for that. So it's always best to do everything on one ticket because then the airlines have to pay to reprotect you when they've got challenges like that. So that's really important. And I can tell you, I've had many clients, not many actually, but I have had several clients lately who we have had challenges with some of their connections, and we've had to, get them rebooked on different days. Thank you, Liz. We had no issues with logistics. We booked for Carl. Yes, thank you, Liz. It's I really do my best to think about all these little details. What are you going to do if you've got 4 hours? And do you want early check-ins or late check-outs? And those can get expensive. So sometimes it's no, but we can always look at alternatives. Like I have one client who was flying into Bora Bora, and they had to do a 3-hour layover before they flew out to Rangiroa, just the way the flights worked, because it was really tough getting the flights for their dates. Well, so I said, well, you're not planning on spending time in Bora Bora, so we could do a lagoon tour for you. So so I think outside of the box to try to do different things to make it work and make it the best trip for my clients. Money matters. This must be probably my number one question that people ask me about. Euros, Canadian dollars, US dollars, XPF, CFP, tipping, credit cards, bank machines, ATMs, all these things that people don't know about. So it's so I'm going to run through some of this. So first of all, the local currency in Tahiti is the French Pacific franc. Two different currency codes for that. It's either XPF or CFP. So French Pacific franc, XPF or CFP. The French Pacific franc is at a set exchange rate to the euro. So it doesn't matter what the euro does, or the French Pacific franc always is at the same exchange rate. So often we talk in euros. When I send my quotes, I'm sending you a quote on your Tahiti package in euros because I work directly with the suppliers in Tahiti. I can also give that in French Pacific francs, but if I tell you it's going to be 2,725,000 French Pacific francs, you're like, what? Right? Even I'm like, what? I got to sit and think and try to calculate it out. So euros is a whole lot easier. Especially right now, because the euro and the US dollar are so close right now, the exchange rate is great. So they are at euros, and that's because they're in overseas territory of France. So that's where the euro connection comes in line. So where to get your money before you go? You can order French Pacific francs through probably any bank or currency exchange place, wherever it is that you live. I would be shocked if they actually stocked it. You probably will have to order it from them, and it will take a week or 2 weeks or whatever it takes them to get the money. Your exchange rate is most likely going to be horrible. You can do it if you want. It's not what I recommend. Once you get down to French Polynesia, there's a bank machine right at the airport. You can withdraw money right there at the airport if you like, and that's what I do. I always take some US dollars or euros with me, or even Canadian dollars, because every hotel will exchange that for me. But again, they're not going to give you the best exchange rate. I use a credit card for almost everything. I'd say 95% of everything I spend when I'm in French Polynesia goes to my credit card. Credit cards are widely accepted. There are some small restaurants, some small shops, some roadside vendors, people like that that won't take credit cards. But credit cards are widely accepted. So you can easily use your credit card. You look at your credit card before you leave, which credit cards you have, what do they charge for foreign exchanges? No matter how you change money, you're gonna lose. Everybody changing money is making money on you. You know, very little options to get it at, you know, at an even exchange rate. But quite often your credit cards and the bank machines are going to give you a better exchange rate than doing it through a bank, a currency exchange place, a hotel desk, a cruise desk, something like that. So that's the rate that I go, the way that I go. A lot of places down there will take US dollars or will take euros if you're paying for something. But keep in mind your exchange will probably be in French Pacific francs. And they may not be giving you the best exchange rate once again. So when I travel anywhere in the world, I usually like to get the local currency and stick with the local currency. Tipping is always a huge question, and it's always a challenging one as well, because tipping is not traditionally part of the French Polynesian culture. Historically, years back, French Polynesians almost viewed it as an insult if you were giving money for service, because they're doing it because they want to, and they almost felt like they're being bribed, I think, you know, for tips. But, you know, that is changing. That has changed. I mean, there are travelers down there. North Americans, we're used to tipping. It's part of our culture. You know, it feels horrible not to. So it's very difficult to go down there and not necessarily tip. But please keep in mind, the Europeans aren't really tipping. It's more of a European style of tipping. If you've traveled to Europe, it's the same thing. You don't finish your meal at the restaurant and add on a 20-25% gratuity. You know, that's just not, it's just not needed. It's just not expected. And you're wasting your money. So you can round up the bills. You can tip a little bit. They will happily take gratuities, but is not really expected and required when you're traveling down there around the islands. So if you do tip, you know, for sure you can tip, but probably not the same amounts as what you might in other places. And it depends on what your services are. If it's a private tour, if it's a butler you've got, things like that, then it's a little more appropriate as well. So another comment here. Laura, thank you for joining, Laura. Nice to see your face here. We had a great experience even when our connecting flight was delayed in LA. Carl to the rescue and worked it all out well. Thank you, Laura. To be honest, it was, how many years ago was that now? I don't even remember that, but I am glad that I was to the rescue and was able to fix that up for you. And Liz, no problem getting money from the ATM at the airport at the end of the vacation, returned any leftover money at the money exchange booth at Papiette. Super easy. Yeah. And the other thing I say is, at the end of your trip and you've got money left, you're checking out of your hotel, pay your hotel bill with whatever cash you have, and then put the balance on your credit card, and then you've got nothing left, right? Anything at the airport, they do accept credit cards. They've got a little food kiosk at the airport and stores and things there, so they all take credit cards. Okay, so that is one of the bigger questions that people always have. Oh, why did it do this to me again? Sorry. So number four, spa. If you are a spa lover, and anybody, I think everybody would agree, you know, this is looking pretty magnificent right here where she is at the Four Seasons enjoying their spa. But if you are a spa lover, it is super important to pre-book appointments. It is something I will do for all of my clients as part of the services I offer to you. I will send you the spa menu. I'll get in touch with the spas locally. I'll make the reservations for you when you tell me what it is that you want. This is especially important post-COVID. COVID has changed mentalities of people and the way they're traveling right now. People are doing bigger trips, they're doing longer trips, and they're spending more money. And it shows. The spas are so busy. If you don't pre-book a spa treatment, you good chance can get down there and you won't be able to get one, or else you certainly, they'll have to slot you in with what's available, or if they get a cancellation kind of thing. So if you're a spa lover, even if you want to just try it once, there's some amazing spas at these resorts. So let me know and I will get you the spa menus, and we will make the appointments. We'll make the appointments ahead of time for you, so we know we've got that all locked in. So really important to do, especially right now. Dinners. And it might be something beautiful like this romantic beach dinner here on the inner lagoon at the St. Regis. It might be dinners at certain resorts. It might be dinners on the islands, Bora Bora at the St. James restaurant, Marae at the Marae Beach Cafe, or Rudy's, things like, you know, things like that. But same thing, reservations are a good idea, especially if you want to do the canoe breakfast, the romantic beach dinners, any of those specialty dinings. You know, this romantic beach dinner in this picture, it can only be one per day that they do, right? So that's a max. The whole world's booking in, these things can get booked up. So any of the specialty dinings, they need to be booked in advance. And certain resorts, I always do dinner reservations for my clients, depending on where you're staying and what the resort is. Some you don't need it. Others, I highly, highly recommend. Sometimes it might just be for a particular restaurant. So at Le Tahoe, if you were doing the fine dining restaurant, we need to reserve that in advance. It's very small. But the other restaurant, you don't need to make dinner reservations. We can leave that, you know, but some of the other resorts where some of the restaurants can be smaller, they can be kind of hard to get into. Like the Brando has a beautiful teppanyaki restaurant, but it's very small. So that teppanyaki restaurant, we want to reserve that in advance so you can have that experience. So it's something else I can do. I can send you dinner menus. I'll let you know what days the restaurants, because restaurants aren't always open 7 days a week at the resorts. One might be open like 5 days a week, 4 days a week, and they rotate and change. So I'll let you know what's open when, help you come up with your dining plan for the resorts. Or like I say, in other cases where you don't need reservations, I can say, you know, don't worry about it. Or only if you're going to dine at this restaurant, and then plan it. If you're planning your own trip, reach out to the resorts, make those reservations in advance if need be, because it is you don't want to get there and be disappointed. And it's only a reservation. You can always change it once you get down there. You change your mind, you want to do room service instead of going to the restaurant, no problem. Just cancel your reservation, right? But at least you have a bit of a plan. Maddie, what's we got here? Carl, is using a debit card the same? Yeah, as long as your debit cards, there's so many banks, Maddie, I'm not sure where you are. This as long as your debit card is like I forget the international, one of the international ones, probably best to check with your bank and see what they say. But a lot of debit cards are accepted, but not all of them. So you do want to watch that. It's I forget now. There's a like an international symbol that where it's, you know, kind of recognized worldwide and at different bank machines. But nowadays debit has become a whole lot better too, because they are accepted, you know, in most places. So you should likely be able to use your debit card as well. The Polynesian culture. I just love this picture. This is what we would call Tahitian mamas. You know, they're the elderly Tahitian ladies and they're more traditional. The Tahitian mamas are usually the ones that make the fresh flower leis, that make the haze that go around the flower crowns that they're wearing around the neck, because they make all those. When you see people wearing them, like, they're very time consuming. They make them all by hand, right? So these would be the classic sort of Tahitian mamas. And I love this picture with them riding their bikes and laughing and smiling. But a little bit about the Polynesian culture before you go down there, because Polynesians are fantastic people. They are very warm. They are very friendly. But they don't like confrontation. They don't like conflict. Like my one Polynesian friend said to me, she said, think of us as a coconut. And when you hold a coconut, it's very hard on the outside. And sometimes Polynesians may appear to be hard on the outside, but once you get inside, we're like the warmest, sweetest, best thing you've ever had. and I think that's the thing with Polynesians. If you walk up to a bar and say, I'll have a beer, they'll probably pour you the beer, they'll put the beer down, they may say absolutely nothing, and you may think they're a little rude. But that's because you haven't had that interaction with them. So take the time to get to know them by name. You know, most resorts, they're wearing a name tag. You know, look at their name tag, you know, talk to them, you know, find out, were they originally born in Bora Bora? Are they from one of the other islands? You know, a little bit about their family. What do you guys do at Christmas? What are your traditions? You know, if they're not busy and you can take the time, it's really, really nice to get to know them. And that's what people love, the Polynesians love. They love the human interaction, they love the human connection. And I think that's what it comes down to more about with the tipping too. Like, you know, they're happier to have great, great people like that than they are to have someone who just throws $5 at them. You know, it's their you know, their personality and their way. And if you have, when I say avoid conflict, if there's ever a problem with your dinner, your room reservation, whatever, we know things can go wrong. How you approach it in French Polynesia will make a world of difference. If you go storming up to a front desk or hollering at a waiter and saying this is unacceptable, and you're explosive, they are going to go into a shell. They are not confrontational people, right? They don't have, there's no such word as stress in Polynesian, in Tahitian. So take the time to calm down, breathe, explain the issue, explain why you're not happy, talk about what they can, you know, talk about what they can do and how can they can resolve it. And you will get so much further than if you come on headstrong like a bully, thinking you're going to bully your way into getting, you know, into getting the answers that you, the answers or the solution that you like. It's just the way their culture works, and all over the world, everybody's got different cultures and how they deal with things. There's a couple more comments here. Maddie, no problem. Amy, this is getting me even more excited for our big trip next year. Excellent. Glad. I hope you get some good tips out of this, Amy. What to pack? This is a big one. I probably could do a whole session on this alone if I wanted to. But just to hit some of the highlights and some of the things to consider. How's my time here? Oh, good. So what to pack? Number one, don't overpack. Most people come home with all sorts of extra clothes that they did not wear. The islands are casual. Even if you're at the highest end resort, it's still quite casual. Cruise lines, check with your cruise lines, but most of the cruise lines that sail down there are also casual and have no formal nights. So it is really nice that way. So don't overpack. Keep in mind all forms of transportation that you're doing and any kind of luggage restrictions that they have. So your international flights, your connecting flights to those international flights, you know, are they charging for bags? How many bags? What are you allowed for carry-on? Your domestic flights between the islands, if you're doing a helicopter tour or a seaplane, taking the ferry, things like that. So take a look at what it is and what you're allowed and try to stay within those allowances, keeping in mind you probably will buy some things to bring it back. So you want to be under the luggage allowance. Some definite things to pack: sunscreen, insect repellent. You can buy these things down there, but they are very expensive in French Polynesia. So I recommend that you pack enough to bring with you, which makes me think maybe I've missed a slide, but I'll see at the end here. Sunscreen though, please try to get eco-friendly, reef-friendly, marine-friendly sunscreen. It's becoming more and more common now. They're changing the sunscreen. But everything we do in Tahiti, and I'm trying to promote this more and more, is let's try to be eco-friendly. Let's try to preserve our planet. And the sunscreen is very hard on the marine life. So get one of the good eco-friendly sunscreens if you can, please. Adapters, keep in mind they are in overseas territory of France. So their plugs are different than what we use in North America. So you want to bring an adapter or two adapters. Depending on the resorts you go to, some of the resorts do have the North American style plugs, not all of them. Me personally, when I travel, I bring at least two adapters. You know, I've got my Bluetooth speaker that needs to be charged. I have my phone that needs to be charged. I have my laptop. My laptop has to be charged. And then my partner's coming along and he's got all this. So I always say two per person. If you're like me and have a lot of the gadgets. But take a look at the adapters and bring the adapters. Some of the resorts do give them in the rooms too, but it's just, again, it all depends on where you're going. Underwater camera, GoPro, something like that. Last week, John actually gave a discount code for anybody that uses iPhones. Go back and watch my presentation with John last week on photography, because he has a deal with one of the companies that gives you the casing for your iPhone so you can use your iPhone underwater. And honestly, after listening to John with that, I think I need to get one of those, because I so love my camera and I do have a GoPro, but I know my camera so much better. I think, wow, take my camera underwater would be great. But there's so much to see underwater. It's just the memories that you get from your underwater shots are so great. The sharks, the stingrays, the coral, Take lots of pictures for underwater pictures though, because it's a whole different world when you're moving underwater, the fish are moving underwater. It's you know, you think you've got the most perfect shots, and all of a sudden you look at it, it's like, oh. You can have a lot of disappointment. So but I really recommend getting some sort of underwater photography element to bring with you, because don't decide once you're there, because then it's too late. Super important, reef shoes. You want to have reef shoes that you wear. There can be a lot of, the islands are formed by coral. It's all coral going around. It forms the lagoon and the coral breaks off. There can be sharp bits of coral in the water. It's really important you wear reef shoes, because you don't want to get coral cuts. So pack a pair of reef shoes. They're small, they're light. You may have to go buy them. I actually don't have it on this list here, but a swim shirt is a good idea as well to protect yourself when you're snorkeling, so you don't get sunburned, is really good. Of course, bring all your medications. There are pharmacies on some of the islands, most of the islands, but you don't want to have to be dealing with that and worrying about trying to get certain medications and things. Travel documents. The biggest thing that people don't think about right now is proof of vaccination if you are fully vaccinated. So make sure you bring that along as well. A Bluetooth speaker. Some resorts are equipped, so you can just connect to their speaker systems, which is really nice, but not all the resorts are. So if you like your music, it's nice to have a little bit of music in your bungalow for sure. Snorkeling gear. I get asked this a lot. Do I bring snorkeling gear? You know, totally up to you if you want to bring your own snorkeling gear or not. All the resorts, unless you're staying in somewhere really small, like the pensions, but all of the big resorts have snorkeling gear that you can borrow. So you can definitely get it there. I have my own mask and snorkel, so I always bring that. I do not bring fins. I'm size 11 feet. They don't fit in a suitcase, and I'm not going to bother carrying those around all separately, right? But I like my mask. I like my snorkel. So I bring my own, but totally up to you if you want to or not. A couple questions coming in. Wen is asking me if it's a C or an E, and honestly, Wen, I totally forget. It's the European with the two round plugs. I can get back to you on that. Don't let me forget. For any of my clients what they get before you leave is you get a Bon Voyage magazine that I've written. So it's an electronic magazine. It's about 30 pages long. It has your packing list in there. It has everything on the currency. It has everything on the travel tips. It's got all kinds of information in there. So I give that to you and it's in there. But when, let me know and I can, don't let me forget, and I can let you know. Steve, are water socks instead of reef shoes okay? To tell you the truth, Steve, I'm not 100% sure of the total difference between the two. if they're water socks, you just want to make sure that something's not going to penetrate through the sole of them. That's the important thing. If you stepped on a sharp piece of coral, or there is another thing, they're called a stonefish, which looks like a piece of coral and can be poisonous if you were to step on that. So you do not want to step on a stonefish. I don't know anybody that has, but they are there in French Polynesia. So you want to make sure that it's not going to pierce through that. So if they have a solid layer on the bottom, Steve, I think they would probably be good. I am just going to backtrack here for a moment, because I'm sure when I accidentally clicked through, I think I skipped a, although nobody noticed, but I think I skipped a bullet point. Yes, I did. So the biggest dangers in French Polynesia. So what are the biggest dangers in French Polynesia? Poisonous snakes roaming through the islands or spiders? None of that. You don't have to worry. There is nothing poisonous on land. It is totally safe. In the water, people think, oh, the sharks or the stingrays. But honestly, when you are in the lagoons, I have swam with hundreds and hundreds of sharks. They are reef sharks. They are smaller. Yes, they are wild animals. Like every wild animal, you have to respect them. But if you do, you are totally fine. The reef sharks are not coming at us like food. We are way too big and they are not interested. They're way too timid and shy. So what are the biggest dangers in French Polynesia? I would say number one, the sun. People can get sunstroke. People can get sick. You go out on the lagoon for the day. You're in and out of the water. That sunscreen washes off. You get horrible burns, right? French Polynesia is close to the equator. The sun is strong. Buy sunblock. Don't go down there with a number 5 oil and put that on because you want to get tan, because you will get fried, right? And if you do that on your first day or two of vacation, you've lost the next 4 or 5 days of vacation because you're feeling miserable. So really get the sunblock. And I totally recommend that you take that sunblock, you put it on in the morning before you walk out of your room. Put it on before you walk up to the resort for breakfast, because what happens is it's a beautiful walk. You stop, you take pictures, you go up, you have a beautiful breakfast, then you decide to walk around the resort a little bit. Before you know it, you come back and poof, you're burned. So put it on every day, first thing in the morning, give yourself a full coat of sunscreen so you're protected, and then reapply often. And once again, try to get the eco-friendly sunscreen. Like I was Googling them the other day, you know, I think 3 years ago, it was really hard to get, and some of them were absolutely horrible. But really, there's a lot of them out there on the market now. And I think that's because Hawaii was going to ban. I think they are banning it, certain types of sunscreen. So the manufacturers have really gotten on board with getting the marine friendly sunscreens. So have a Google there. And then the other thing that I was going to say is dangerous is the coral cuts. So here I've got the picture of the reef shoes on there. The coral's just a little bit about coral, because coral is a living organism. It is super, super important that we try to protect the coral. Never, ever stand on a coral. Don't hit the coral. Don't break the coral. Don't snap a piece off to bring it home as a souvenir. It takes forever for coral to grow, and it's having a hard enough time with global warming right now that we don't need to have our use and abuse destroying it. But like I say, there is a lot of broken coral. Some breaks off naturally, a lot breaks off naturally just from the waves and over time. So there is a lot of broken coral in the lagoons. So you want to wear the reef shoes to protect you from that. And then just in case to any of the stonefish, you don't want to get stung by a stonefish. But otherwise, French Polynesia is a super safe place. You know, it is an overseas territory of France, and the overseas territory of France, therefore they have a lot of French regulations. So the food is very safe. The quality of medical care is very good. They are very, very isolated, but it is a very, very safe, safe destination. And like I say, on the land side, no poisonous snakes, no poisonous spiders, nothing like that you have to worry about if you're off hiking through the bush. So that's really good. Where are we at now? Top souvenirs. So I have a full presentation actually on souvenirs. So if you go back in my YouTube channel, you will find a presentation like 40 minutes long, 50 minutes long, just about Tahitian souvenirs. But a quick rundown, Tahitian pearls, probably the number one souvenir that people buy. They come in all prices. They come in all, you know, all kinds of things that you can, beautiful jewelry, earrings, necklaces, rings, you know, you name it, you buy them individual, like in the picture here. I just did three weeks ago, the presentation with Richard Wan, who's the grandson of Robert Wan. And Robert Wan was the one who really elevated the level of pearls in French Polynesia and got them classified as a gem. So you can go back and watch that presentation if you want to learn a lot more about the pearls. And for any of my clients that are really into pearls, when we're planning your trip, let me know. I can set up a time for you to meet Richard at the Pearl Museum downtown Papeete to learn all about the pearls. You can get a bit of a guided tour of the museum as well if you wanted. So we can always do that. But Tahitian pearls, you will see them everywhere. Manoi oil, I don't have it behind my green screen, so I won't grab it right now. But manoi oil is an oil made of coconut oil and then it's scented with different Polynesian scents. And the locals use it on their skin to soften their skin. They put it in their hair. It smells wonderful. I keep it here in my office, especially in the wintertime. I just open it up and the smell of it just makes me feel like I'm back in Tahiti. So take a look at the manoi oil. Some of the resorts may give it out as a little gift. You can buy it in all the gift shops. And they have different versions of it as well. So they've got some that is just the straight manoi oil. They got the different scents and flavors of it. But they have some actually with insect repellent built in as well. So you can buy it with manoi oil with insect repellent. So that's a great practical souvenir. Tahitian vanilla, some of the best vanilla in the world. It's not inexpensive, but it is some of the most flavorful. It makes a great souvenir, a great gift. You can buy the vanilla beans, you can buy the paste, you can buy the liquid, whatever form you want, you can pick it up and bring it home with you. The pareos, the Tahitian pareos, or other places they're called, Fiji, they call them the sulus, other places called the sarongs, probably the most common name, but in French Polynesia, it's called a pareo. You can get all kinds of pareos down there, everything from cheap mass market manufactured ones that probably came from China to other ones that are artistic, where artists actually, and I do have a video on my YouTube channel about that, about what it's like, how the artists hand paint them, stretch them out, dry them in the sun, sign them, so you can get the pareos. The most permanent tattoo, of course, which when my brother comes with me in November, he wants to get. I think him and his wife are going to get a tattoo. So you can definitely look at the tattoos. Tahitians are famous for their wood carvings and their stone carvings. I have tons of their wood carvings here in my house. I absolutely love them. Not the stone carvings so much. They're a little heavier to bring home, but definitely you'll see those all over the place. So they make great souvenirs. And then the tapa cloth as well. So the tapa cloth is made from the bark of a tree, and they stretch it out. And traditionally, the tapa was used to wrap for ceremonies. They would wrap the people getting married. They'd use it for funerals. They'd use it for the kings. So it was a real status symbol as well. But you can always pick up a piece of tapa cloth. I actually have a huge one in my den that's framed and hangs over over my couch. So those are a few of the souvenirs that you can look for when you're down there. And then one last thing to talk about is tours and activities. Please don't go. I say this all the time, but please don't go and book a resort. If you just want to stay at a beautiful resort, there's lots of those around. You know, get out there and experience the islands and experience the culture, meet the people. You know, when I book tours for my clients, the majority of the time I try to use companies that have Polynesian guides, Polynesian owned and operated. Again, sticking with that sustainable travel, we're giving back to the community. It's not always the case, depending on what it is that you want to do, but I try when possible to do that. And it's a great way for you to get a much better feel for people and for the culture. So pre-book, because once again, things are booking up like crazy. I just was booking somebody for September 2023. I'm booking my most favorite private lagoon tour for them. The day we picked, he was already booked, because it's one person, one boat, right? It's happened to me twice now for late 2023, where the day we picked, he was booked. I mean, it's not a problem because we can switch it to another day, but that's that much in advance. So definitely you know, pre-book your tours. Again, if you're booking through me, don't worry. I'll fill you in on everything as to where to go. But if you are booking your tours, I had somebody the other day who booked a helicopter tour, and I'm like, well, where are they picking you up? Is it leaving from the helicopter base on the main island, or are they picking you up at the resort? Because they're two different things and they're two different price points. And if it's on the main island, you're going to have to take a boat over there, and then you're going to have to take a taxi, right? So know your tours as to where and when they pick you up and how you get in touch with them, you know, should there be any issues or problems. What to bring on tours, you know, always bring water with you. You are in the tropics. Depending on the time of year, it can be super, super hot. So always bring water with you. If you're snorkeling or anything water-based, usually bring your towels, your snorkel, your mask, your fins. Some companies provide it, but most of them, you know, you bring it along. Either you've got your own or you get them from the resort. If you're doing anything land-based, I always say to bring, put on and or bring your insect repellent as well. Usually the insects aren't bad at the resorts and things like that, but when you get into the interior, that's where you can get really bad. And the other thing is be ready. So if they say it's a pickup time at 9 o'clock, don't come strolling into the lobby at 9:01. You know, if it's a transfer and you're leaving a resort, remember you have to allow time to check out at the front desk. Shared tours especially, if you're late, you're holding up everybody else on the tour. So I always try to be there at least 5 minutes early so that, you know, if they show up early, you can go early. But if not, you can, you know, you're there, you're ready. And don't panic if they're 5 or 10 minutes late, because it could be that same reason. They just left another resort and somebody wasn't ready early. So they're late getting to you to pick you up. But just, you know, be prepared. Have your little mental checklist of what you're bringing on every tour. I always, especially morning tours, I always plan the night before. So I'm in my room. Okay, I've got my little backpack. I bring a little day pack. Right. So I throw in my sunscreen, my insect repellent, a bottle of water, my towel, my mask, my snorkel. In the morning, I'll get up, I'll go to breakfast, I'll bring that with me, have my breakfast, go from the breakfast right down and take off on the tour. So I don't even have to go back to the room. So think a little bit ahead and try to be organized for your tours, so you are all on time and you just get out there and enjoy. What do we have? Comments here. Fred, what does Fred say? Is tap water drinkable? Papiette and Le Taha. They are going to recommend bottled water, Le Taha. I have to say, I have drank tap water before. It is filtered. It doesn't taste the, you know, it doesn't taste the best. Papiette, it is drinkable as well. Some of the locals will say it's horrible, and they, you know, you should drink bottled water, but it's definitely drinkable in Papiette. Le Taha as well, Fred. I don't know if they've got it yet. I know one of the things a lot of the resorts are looking at doing to try to cut down on the bottles from bottled water, which I'm so happy about this because the plastic and the glass waste is off the charts, but they're looking at putting in refillable water stations. So bring a water bottle. In fact, I should put that on the packing list. I'm going to write that down, but bring a refillable water bottle because they're starting to set up, you know, filtered water stations where you can just fill your bottle. And you don't have to be buying it. And that just helps so much with the environment as well. Oh, Todd, thanks for joining. Sorry, I miss you trying to catch up with your live chat. Everything's recorded, Todd. You've got it all there. You've got it all there on YouTube. You can go back at any point in time. I see you're on Facebook right now, but YouTube is the best place. If you go to youtube.com/TahitiByCarl, everything is everything. Every one of these that I've ever done is recorded and stored on there. So you can always go back and watch them there. And I will be in touch with more information there that you emailed me about earlier today. Maddie, staying at the Conrad Hotel. How do I pre-book excursions? Well, I always do the excursions for my clients. If you haven't booked with a travel agent, then you need to get in touch with Conrad. So reach out to the Conrad Resort, to their concierge over there. They'll be able to send you a list of excursions, and they can organize excursions and activities for you, but do it in advance. Okay. And that is everything. Does anybody else have any questions while we're still here? How's my time? Wow, I'm almost hitting an hour. I always amaze myself how much I can talk all on my own. Thank you, everybody, for joining. It was a great turnout tonight, and I really, really appreciate it. I hope people found this useful. I hope you enjoyed it. Like I said at the beginning, if you did, you know, drop a little comment, drop a little comment, give a like or a thumbs up there in Facebook or YouTube. And if you want to catch more of these, like I try to do them every single Thursday, 5 p.m. Eastern time. If you subscribe to my YouTube channel, and then if you ring the little bell here for the notifications, it'll notify you every time I go live. So you'll get a notification on your phone saying Carl's gone live. And even if you don't catch it live, you can always... you know, it reminds you that it is there, and you can always go back and watch it afterwards. But thank you once again for joining. Oh, one second here, a few more things. Maddie, I'll be there on March 23rd. I booked through Costco and they don't do them. Okay, but that's really horrible. I know people love booking through Costco, but I'm sorry. I've had so many nightmare stories. I do not recommend them whatsoever. Very, very different experience, but they should do them for you because they can reach out to the resort and do it that way if they don't have direct contracts with the suppliers. But to be honest, I just think they don't want to take the time to do it for you. So definitely reach out to the Conrad direct. Carol, thanks for joining as always. I'm glad you enjoyed. Liz, thank you. Wen, so small, I almost didn't see it. Little Island, thanks for joining again, Wen. Who else here? Wow, look at all these. Kimberly, thanks, Carl. November is coming fast for all of us. Yes, very exciting. It's when we're all going 40. I think I've got 48 people going with me on the Paul Gauguin cruise in November. So it's going to be a big group and lots of fun. Bob, who's all booked. Thank you, Bob. Thanks for joining. Glad you found the information helpful. And you will be getting, Bob, a lot more information as we get closer to your departure date. Maddie, you are more than welcome. Steve, you are more than welcome. I will see you in Tahiti. Oh my gosh, they keep on rolling in here. Diana, great info. Thanks. We can't wait for our trip. Excellent. So yes, thank you everybody. I am going to wrap up next. I have gone over or almost exactly an hour long point here, which is kind of the max I want to have. So once again, as they say in Tahiti, maruru, thank you for joining. And when you say goodbye in Tahiti, you just say nana. So nana, and I hope to see you all next week, same time, same place. And whoever is my clients and you've come back from Tahiti, I need pictures. So reach out and send me your pictures so I can keep the photos going each week here on the live broadcast. All right. Take care. Bye-bye.